Another edition of the Stampede Wrestling Show, and what a show it's going to be, of that I am sure. We've got a six-man tag. We'll take a look at that. We've got Strangler Steve DeSalvo going against Phil LaFleur. Boy, that's a fight that's long been awaited. And listen to this for the main event. Would you believe Mukka Singh and Bad News Allen against, yes, the combination of Owen Hart and Jason the Terrible? Could be frightening. We'll start to frighten you in just a moment, okay? All right, let's concentrate on Hashib Khan out of Mongolia against Mr. Hito of Tokyo. Moving toward the 10-minute mark, a little slapping match at mid-ring. That smarts a little bit.
I'll tell you, just as I said when I was talking to you earlier here at ringside, Mr. Hito has been asserting himself, but finally it looks like the Mongolian champion, Hashib Khan, is making some good use of that 50-pound weight advantage he has over the Tokyo veteran, Mr. Hito.
Well, this is Khan's first rally in the fight. Oh, I have run into so many people who wanted to talk about Jason the Terrible. Who would have thought a bad guy like that would end up with a good guy combination and indeed be a hero to these people after the terrible way he behaved when he first hit the territory?
Jason the Terrible, I think, ever since he unmasked the Zodiac, has been a changed man. We will find out tonight just how much he has changed and whether or not Owen Hart has misplaced trust in a wrestler that is, I think you could say, the one operative word, unpredictable. The man growls, he grunts, he raves. You can't ever understand what the heck he's saying or what's going on in that cranium behind the mask, but it's going to be interesting when he teams up with Owen Hart against Bad News Allen and Mukka Singh in our main event.
Well, they x-rayed, you may not know this, they x-rayed Jason the Terrible, x-rayed his head the other day. They found nothing, you know. I mean, it was... Steady.
Whoa!
Whoa! Okay, Hashib. He's being a bit of a meanie right now, is our Hashib Khan.
10 minutes gone. 5 minutes remaining.
We've just slipped past the 10-minute mark, says Barry Russell, our timekeeper. Tommy Carr, the longtime timekeeper here, is holidaying in Las Vegas, Nevada. Boy, timekeeping must be paying off.
Well, he's a rough and tough hombre. He's down, Tommy Carr, in Vegas, but he was down there with the Cowboys checking out the rodeo action. He's a cowpoke at heart, and he's a very tough hombre, as I said, but I feel just as secure sitting beside good old Barry Russell the Muscle.
Russell the Muscle? I believe that's an adequate description. Compounding just a two count there. Wayne Hart, referee of the year, the past year, in this territory, overseeing the proceedings. Hashib is a very noisy fighter. If he ever got laryngitis, he might not be quite as effective. I don't know.
Well, Hashib Khan looks like a cross between a professional wrestler and a sumo wrestler of the Japanese ilk. He carries a lot of weight on his frame, 270 pounds. He is a big man and a bit of a plotter, but he is very effective, and he has rallied well against Mr. Hito, and currently it has been all Hashib Khan in the later stages, and if he continues this, I would say The odds of him putting away Mr. Hito are very, very good.
Well, there's the arm going down twice. Will it do it again? No, it will not. Had it gone down the third time, that would have been meant for the match. Hito trying to express some indignation here. There's 3 minutes left in regulation time. And in a legal sense, we do not do like they do in hockey, football, etc. We don't go to overtime. Although some bad guys have been tending to disregard that of late. Here we go now. Turn around. Pulls him over the top, that big weight.
Mr. Hito with a spirited rally. He is not letting this 50-pound weight disadvantage bother him one little bit. A great rally by Mr. Hito. Can he put Hashim Khan away? Remember, we only have 120 seconds left in regulation time. Hito attempting to dispatch Hashim Khan, and here he goes. He's going upstairs.
Long flight. And yes, indeed, there was a malfunction at the junction. He takes a martial arts kick to the jaw, and I think that Hito made a grave mistake in trying that long, long flight. He was too far away. That could do it. It's a one, it's a two, and it's a three. And there is your winner from Mongolia, Hashim Khan.
Okay, here we are with the Great Gamma, Champagne, Jerry Morrow, and Garfield Ports. And Great Gamma, I want to start with you. I want to say it's good to see you back, but only because it means you can finally put that Commonwealth mid-heavyweight title up for grabs. People have been getting tired of waiting.
It's quite obvious, Jim Davies. The pleasure is all yours. I know the people in Canada have been dying for my presence back in this country, but I hate to tell you people, I was on a very, very successful tour of the world in South Africa. I took on two of the best South Africans and made mincemeat out of them. I went to India, I went to Pakistan, and I went to England. I defeated the best that they had to put against me for this title. As you can see, I came out the winner one more time.
I've got to ask you.
Don't stop me. You don't have to ask me. Let me talk. When I'm talking, don't you dare stop me. And another thing, when I went home to Karachi, Pakistan, they gave me the red carpet treatment. The red carpet was laid out in the street of Karachi, Pakistan. As I paraded through the main street, the people on their hands and knees, the treatment that only a champion deserves. Something that you people should be doing the same thing for me here. You haven't done that. You met me in the dressing room. You just gave me a cold handshake, young Dave. You should have been on your hands and knees, and you should have kissed the palm of my hand.
Okay, so I'll put you under a pedestal. Under a pedestal.
This belt's going to be resting on my waist a long time because I'm going to take a break because I had a very, very tough time out there. So I'm not worried about putting the title on the line against Chris Benoit, Owen, Bruce, or whoever you got, because I'm going to involve myself in a bunch of tag team matches and take it easy.
Okay, the champagne man.
Well, Jim Davies, when Mr. Gamma Singh, the Great Gamma, wasn't there, I told him what happened about Owen Hart, what he interfered. Me and the Maka Singh, we're supposed to have the tag team champion, and what Owen do. He know about it. So, Carl Garfield.
Let me say one thing. Everything the Great Gamma told me was true. It seems I got here just in time. And let me tell you, since I've been here, I've been talking to the magistrates about the laws that have been being broken by the Hart family, about Owen Hart, that punk kid hiding behind his belt. Let me tell you, as a legal advisor for the Karachi Vice, the champagne man, the Great Gamma Abdullah, are going to reign supreme, the Karachi Vice. As long as Garfield Ports is the legal advisor, the sky's the limit for the Karachi Vice.
Okay, conceded. These guys have stretch marks on their heads.
You got to admit it. You got a tough assignment, Owen Hart and Jason the Terrible. This could be your Waterloo. I hate to say that.
I know you hate, you love to say that, King Edward, but don't believe it, because those beer belly sharecroppers out there know, you know in your heart, and I know there's no way that P-Brain and the Spineless Cockroach is going to beat the combination of Maka Singh and Bad News Allen, the Ultimate Warrior. This is going to be Christmas early because the Spineless Cockroach made me wait a long time before he got back in the ring with me, and he's going to hide, I'm sure, through the whole match behind that P-Brain, who has no brain. The only thing he's got is power. When we get done with them, they're going to know what the law is about. They're going to know what true fear is about. No mercy.
No mercy.
You know what these two remind me of, Waylon? They remind me of two characters out of The Wizard of Oz. One has no brain and one has no courage. You can make up your own mind which one is which. But I'm going to tell you something, simpleton behind the mask. When we get done with you tonight, Bad News Allen and I are going to set our sights on that North American belt that the little Omar's been hiding from us for too long now. He's been hiding it. He keeps tucking it away. He'll even come in the ring with an idiot with a mask just to have a tag match to stay away from us. Get ready, Omar, because one of us is going to get you, and it's going to be before you know it.
Okay, I wonder if they'll talk so big after the match, huh? In the hinterlands, it's Kerry Brown, Kansas City, Biff Wellington, Lloydminster. Finally, Brown gets into the middle after taking advantage of Wellington, who was shaken up as he was thrown out of the ring. Referee Hart warning Brown to straighten up his act, which he's not exactly doing, bangs him into the turnbuckle.
Well, we are approaching the 10-minute mark, and I would say most of this bout has been dominated by young Biff Wellington. But Kerry Brown, he calls himself the new improved Kerry Brown, about 30 pounds less blubber on that frame than there was in earlier days. He's now a svelte, trim, needle-like 265 pounds of blubber.
Oh! I don't want you to say that to his face. Out goes Wellington. Now Brown is headed just above us, outside. A yellow card being shown to Kerry Brown.
Yellow card.
Gives him a shot outside. And the count goes on. Kerry Brown simply does not want Wellington to be in the ring.
Oh, Kerry Brown is still in the early phases of the cards here. He has not worked himself up into main event category, and that does disturb him. It frustrates him, makes him mad. In the days when he was teamed up with Duke Myers as the Masters of Disaster, he was a regular main eventer. But now, he is strictly preliminary material, and he is not too thrilled about that.
Just before he delivered that knee drop to the side of the head of Wellington, he looked at me and said, "This is for you." Gee, I'm not particularly charmed about that. Brown is celebrating, but perhaps the celebration is taking, well, it's being taken a little early because this thing is not over. Wellington has good stamina. He's proven that. Right now, it's a good pounding he's getting, unfortunately.
Well, like I said, Brown has only been back in the territory for a very short time. Look at him coming across with that chair, wraps the head of Biff Wellington. And he gets another yellow card. One more warning, and he is disqualified. Kerry Brown ranked number 9 in the heavyweight division. Meanwhile, Biff Wellington ranked 4th in the Commonwealth mid-heavyweight division.
In other words, translated, Kerry Brown right now is the Rodney Dangerfield of the territory. No respect. Not getting any respect from the crowd either, is he?
A frustrated, I agree with you, Jim, a frustrated Kerry Brown, annoyed about the lack of spotlight. The ego is a little bit raw. Hip toss, wraps him up. But that is not going to take Mr. Wellington out of the affair.
3 minutes remaining.
Well, he has only 3 minutes left, Kerry Brown does, to pin his man, and you know that he's going to have to pin Biff Wellington if he wants to move up the ladder in the heavyweight rankings. Wellington off the ropes. Oh, just not even a two count. Kerry Brown was a little shocked at that maneuver, but he immediately threw off Wellington, and he has that evil look in his eye as he comes down hard with that big elbow. Wellington with that good body block off the ropes. Yes, it was surprising. A beautiful job. This is one fall. 15-minute time limit. Kerry Brown, Biff Wellington.
Two minutes remaining.
Barry Russell tells us there's 2 minutes remaining in regulation time. This could go the limit.
If Biff Wellington can manage a draw with Big Kerry Brown, it'll be a serious setback for Brown's hopes at another shot at that North American heavyweight title. And now it's all Wellington.
Look at him go to work here. Brown is on Strange Street. The hip toss. Can he get him down? Knee drop to the throat cover. One, two, that's all. An explosive performance here by Biff Wellington. Can he put him away? Here's the cover. No, sir. He wants timeout.
1 minute.
He's been watching too many football games.
There is no timeout in professional wrestling, and there's less than a minute left in this bout. It looks to me like we could see a draw here. Oh, look at that. Wellington's neck could have snapped when he came down on the turnbuckle. Quite the maneuver by Kerry Brown. Big elbow smash. One, two, three, it's all over. Kerry Brown, the Kansas City Bomber, takes another step up the road in the North American heavyweight rankings.
Strangler Steve DeSalvo, and you've got a little date
another
with destiny.
You, isn't it?
It's a huge honor, if I can only somehow be still my heart.
Well, just grovel on your knees.
I'll grovel later. But I wanted to ask you. Okay, now I wanted to ask you, date with destiny on this card, Phil LaFleur.
It's going to be an early Christmas for his parents. I'm going to send his body back. Oh, wait, Air Canada's on strike, but then again, they only have prop planes in Canada anyways. Maybe we can send him on CP Rail if there's going to be any pieces left. Mr. LaFleur, s'il vous plaît, je ne sais pas. Of course, I don't speak French, but Mr. LaFleur, the destiny has come. Your demise is going to happen here. In this fabulous arena, in front of all these cretins and peasants, they get to see you slither on the ground like a cockroach that you are. Sure, you attacked me from behind. I'm not even upset, Mr. LaFleur, because I'm so sure of myself that I'm going to take you down, and it's not going to be a three count, Mr. LaFleur. It's not going to be a submission hold. It's going to be a beating that you'll always remember, and your parents will always remember.
Okay, okay. Got to ask you, am I mistaken? Or the last time I saw you and Phil LaFleur standing together, it was him standing, you running.
Don't mean a thing to me. My response to that is, but, Mr. Davies, I just want to say one thing. After LaFleur's demise, I'm not going to tell these peasants exactly what I have in store for them. It could be Omar Owen or whatever his name is, Hart, Brucey Hart, Mr. Pillman, or, you know what I'd like?
Is
to
You'll
take
tell
Jason.
Him.
Oh, you bet I will. Is to take Jason, that Neanderthal brain of his, Cro-Magnon brain, that little microscopic brain,
and take him with that mask on and take this 26 inches, maybe 27. That's about as big as your head, so it's probably about a 33. No brain in your head either. Take that and just take, like, back up just a little bit. Take a wide lens of this shot and just boom, like that. And watch his head flop back. And maybe with that mask, I can pick it up. Maybe I could stick it on Mr. LaFleur's Christmas tree on top of it. Wouldn't that be nice? Maybe I could give it to you.
Lovely idea.
You can't afford a Christmas tree either, can you?
No, I can't. My Christmas tree, the welfare termites moved out. Thank you very much, Strangler Steve DeSalvo.
There they are, the dynamic duo, Mr. Hart and Mr. Terrible, I guess you call him. Owen, are you comfortable?
Well, you know, Ed, we couldn't be more ready. Now, last week I was a little bit untrusting to Jason, but I spent my time with him all this week, and we've built up a real friendship. We got a lot of trust in each other, and we're like a bond. We're going to stick together, and tonight we got Bad News Allen and Muck and Singh, two guys that I know Jason and I would love to get rid of, and tonight is the night that we're going to do it. Jason, we're ready.
Jason, I'll tell you, Jason, I'm gonna do a word association test here. I want your reaction to the words Mukka Singh. Well, okay. How about Bad News Allen? Okay, I think you get the idea. Boy, this is something different.
I'll tell you, Ed, tonight's the night. Jason and I couldn't pick a better partner. We're ready. We're ready to go. It's only a matter of hours. We're stepping in the ring, and those guys are going down.
Okay. Owen Hart, Jason the Terrible. Well, here we go. Six-man tag. I am cracked up here because, honestly, well, I was terrorized in that ring by Jerry Morrow. What else is new? Just because I called him Rot Gut Champagne Jerry. Anyway, he has combined with Great Gama and Garfield Parts against the combination. Look at this. The combination of Bruce Hart, Brian Pillman, and Johnny Smith. Wow. This should be your patented ring-a-ding-dong dandy, Jürgen Herrmann, the referee. Here we go.
And you'll see non-stop action when you're looking at a six-man tag team affair. This will be wild. I'll tell you what, Ed Whalen, in future, you may refer to Jerry Morrow as Ripple Jerry Morrow or Thunderbird Jerry Morrow, perhaps.
Look out. Little ring around the rosy there. Smith, a big tag. Brian Pillman coming in. Up those ropes now. Good shoulder block. Boy, did he send him flying. This is great action.
I'll be interested to see the Great Gamma when he gets in the ring, to see if he's lost anything or picked anything up during his tour of Asia and Africa. He is a good one, the Commonwealth mid-heavyweight champion, but we have not seen him in the territory for some time now.
How about that for a double whammy? Beautiful work here by Pillman. Tag Bruce Hart. The clothesline. Oh, he loves to hang him out to dry, does Bruce Hart. Solid hitting action. Pillman's going up top. And Morrow is the landing pad.
Thus far in the bout, it has been all Bruce Hart, Brian Pillman, and Johnny Smith. They have totally dominated. There's the tag, and now we are going to see what Gamma has to offer. And the Great Gamma looks like maybe he should have taken another couple of weeks before returning to the territory. He's already in big trouble. Look at this. His arm has dropped twice, but no. Gives Force a little gouge, but once again, outside interference. Keep in mind,
The team of Gamma, Morrow, and Ports have two yellow cards, and if they continue this outside interference, they'll be disqualified. They'll be out of there.
3 minutes remaining. 3 minutes.
There's a two count again with less than 3 minutes now remaining in regulation time. Smith, the victim of a mugging by all three at various stages, trying to get over to make the tag. He does make the tag. The referee didn't see it. He didn't see it. Oh, no.
No, the referee, Jürgen Hermann, was distracted. It's now a little bit of a street fight in there, and the referee is caught in the middle. He's trying to restore order, but it's almost impossible. And right now, Johnny Smith has been taking a beating at ringside. He's in trouble. Look at this. Garfield Ports coming off the top rope. Oamo!
That may do it, but the referee was looking the other way.
Less than 2 minutes remaining.
He was not an eyewitness to the skullduggery, and it's going to happen again. Oh, what a pile driver. Now the cover, now the one, now the two, now the... Well, you got the benefit of a referee who can't count to three.
Ed Willen, it's quite obvious to me and everybody here that two is a favorite number with you, Jim Davies, the rest of the people in Calgary. I don't think you people can count past two. Seems like the Flames don't ever score.
What is it? I don't understand. I don't understand your count.
My English is not so good, but I can count. One, two, three is eins, zwei, drei.
Right. Okay. Well, you counted two.
You have it in English.
Two.
You get it in any language you want. Three is all the same. We beat those guys. You're so
good. A tarnished win. Tarnished.
I have irrefutable and conclusive evidence that the bad company, the team of Brian Pillman and Bruce Hart, have been beaten. Now, you guys, being the gentlemen that you are, please, tomorrow, Federal Express those belts to me.
The belt?
Federal Express.
That wasn't a title match. What are you talking about?
So I can have them underneath my Christmas tree.
Oh, that's really nonsense. You haven't got any belts.
We can't even have a match. Three against three. The Great Gamma, Macassin, myself, my great, the best one. And yeah. Don Owen and Bruce and Pullman put their belt down, and the three of us can get it right away.
That's, what did you say? Well, what we've got here is two newcomers to the territory. We've got Jonathan Holliday and Brick Bronski, and they are two good-looking young men, and I'll tell you what, we're glad to have you here, and maybe you could tell us a little bit about yourself, Jonathan.
Well, I'll tell you what, we thought that New York, L.A., and Miami had what life had to offer, but we got in Calgary this morning and stepped off the plane, and I saw some of the best-looking women God had to offer, and I said to myself, hey, I want to marry a Canadian woman. From what we can see, we've got plenty of competition to keep us busy with Stampede Promotions, with Bad News Allen, Maka Singh, whoever, it doesn't matter. I think Brick can fill you in on the rest.
Well, Brick, there's no need to get into our background. We are only looking to the foreground. And yes, we are happy to be here in Canada. I think it's one of the most aesthetically pleasing places in the world, and I've been around. Yes, Stampede Promotions has some of the best competition in the world. However, we are here for one reason and one reason only, and that's to eliminate this disease, this pestilence, this vermin known collectively as Karachi Vice. And if you don't think, or any of the boys out there don't think that we can get the job done, you take a look at this and you tell me that they've got another thing coming.
That's Brick Bronski.
Thank you.
Jonathan Holliday. These are two newcomers, and you can bet you'll be hearing a lot more about them. We're just past the five-minute mark. Strangler Steve DeSalvo doing his posing as per usual. His ego as big as his body. At 290, Phil LaFleur. 230, Montreal. 45-minute time limit. Jürgen Hermann looking on. Looks to me like DeSalvo's doing a little strangling in order to live up to his name. Flings his man across the ring.
DeSalvo
has amazing strength. He is not quick afoot, but he has amazing power. I'll tell you one thing, too. Some bouts are billed as a grudge match, and they don't really follow through with that. This is an honest-to-goodness grudge match. These two men hate each other. LaFleur is going to have problems if he gets in close. I know he doesn't want to back down, but he must not go to close range against the strength of this guy. He's got to circle him, do the Muhammad Ali thing, float like a butterfly, and do his bee stinging from long range. See, there's the problem of dealing with that weight and strength.
LaFleur, as you say, cannot get into a pure match of strength because he is outmatched, despite the fact he's a very powerful young man, but he has to utilize his quickness in the ring. Right now, it is all DeSalvo. This bout started off with LaFleur dominating because he was utilizing that speed. Now, when they're in close quarters, you can see DeSalvo dominating. Whoa! Now that would smart a three-point landing on his two knees and his noggin. LaFleur in trouble. He is shaken up. And you can see that the big man, DeSalvo, is loving every minute of it.
Well, we have not heard any three counts, so DeSalvo should not be counting his chickens. Mind you, I'm not sure that Jürgen Hermann can count to three. Right now, he's counting LaFleur to his feet. And LaFleur needs the aid of the ropes to get up there.
Well, you can see that Strangler Steve DeSalvo is in control. He just was massaging the neck of Phil LaFleur. For that, he earns his second yellow card. He is very close to being disqualified for some of these tactics that he's using, but LaFleur cannot count on that, and I'm sure the man that he is, he would not want to win by a disqualification.
Well, LaFleur made a quick move. Gosh, he is getting mauled, is he not? As we move toward the 10-minute mark, big jam up on the ropes. Things went sour there for DeSalvo. He kisses the concrete. LaFleur with a very solid rally here. Bottom coming in. He's doing a good job, his young Phil.
A spirited comeback by the man they call the Montreal Sensation. Did you see him pick up that 290-pounder? No shortage of strength to go with his great speed. And now LaFleur comes over the top rope, lands flush on DeSalvo, but amazing strength of DeSalvo. He just threw him off like a Cupid doll.
Can he do the pile driver? Yes, he can! Big knee drop. He may have him. One, two, no, just.
10 minutes gone. 10 minutes.
Again off those ropes. Look, Godinelli. Strangler Steve saved himself there. Gets out of the ring. LaFleur goes upstairs, bangs them around.
Well, I'll tell you what's happening while they're beating on each other outside the ring. The referee is counting the two men out.
They'd better get back in quickly. LaFleur seems to be content to beat on DeSalvo. He cannot make it in. That is it. A 10 count. Both men have been counted out outside the ring, but the battle is still going on.
Well, it'll go into the record books as a double count out. In other words, a draw. Bill LaFleur, Steve DeSalvo, they don't want to quit. Somebody better tell them the match is over. You told me before the match it was a piece of cake, no contest. You didn't win.
What do you mean I didn't win?
It was a count out.
You see LaFleur now? Where is he? The object isn't winning. I always win.
You always do.
No matter what I do, I win in life. I'm a winner. Yeah. I'm a perfectionist. I'm the best there is. Mr. LaFleur, where's Mr. LaFleur?
He'll be out in a minute.
The ambulance right now is attending to him.
The ambulance?
I said earlier that I would send his Jason's head back to LaFleur's house for Christmas. They can stick it on top of the Christmas tree.
Yeah, wonderful.
But the best thing is they can send, I'll send Phil's body back. And they'll be able to stick
Phil's body. You're terrible. What a spirit you've got.
Oh, I love Christmas.
Yes, okay.
Of course, in Canada, that's all I'd have to do is give Canadian, the government, all my money.
Good
which
idea.
Which is going to be 7-8 figures
right,
anyways.
Right.
But Mr. Whalen, as you saw, it's an honor for you to watch me today. The people of Canada, although they're groveling on their knees, kissing their TV because I'm here.
Yes.
And I do love that. But you know, it's an insult for me to the people of Canada to even root for me. It's degrading for me. Now, the people in the States, they all love me. Because, you know,
I have trouble following this, yeah?
Do you really?
Yes.
Well, you would because you're Canadian. But the thing is, the best thing is, as DeSalvo speaks, the whole world's going to listen.
Well, you're like E.F. Hutton.
Right now, better than E.F. Hutton. You steal my lines, Mr. Yeah. Let me just give the people of Canada something. And Mr. LaFleur, when you crawl back out, think of this. That was just one time. One little beating. You'll never be the same. It's like Muhammad Ali.
All right.
He's got that brain disease. The same thing with
him. Oh, yeah, sure. Okay, there he is.
Well, Phil LaFleur, you and Steve DeSalvo were counted out outside the ring. I thought that was very unfortunate. I thought you were in control, but I also had the feeling that's only the first battle in the war that you want to wage against DeSalvo.
Well, Jim, as much as I hate to admit it, but that is one tough dude. He showed me that tonight. There's one thing he's missing, and that's right in there. And I know that's my advantage over you. Steve DeSalvo, you started the battle, but the war is not over. Because when you smashed my chop and you put them stitches in your head, I said one day I was getting my soul revenge. And I tried tonight. I tell you, I say sorry to all the people because I don't feel satisfied. I thought I was going to kick his butt more, but I didn't get the chance. But let me tell you, Steve DeSalvo, the next time me and you get in here face to face, one of us is going down and not getting up, and I can guarantee you that.
And I'll tell you what, Strangler Steve DeSalvo is the one that's going to be down if Phil LaFleur has his way.
Mr. B, it's bad news, Alan. And Mukka Singh against Jason the Terrible and Owen Hart. Bad news, Alan, going against Jason on the table. Mukka and Owen at the moment are holding their distance. Mukka Singh has been cut by Jason. And bad news, Alan, bending his spleen on Jason for doing that. Crowd still cheering for Jason. We're about the 10-minute mark. We're nearing it at any rate. One fall, 1 hour time limit.
Jason in trouble, but Owen Hart gets involved, and it is good to see that Jason has not double-crossed Owen Hart. That was a concern, but Jason is in all kinds of trouble himself now. Look at that big knee drop. One, two, and once again, Owen Hart gets involved. And for that, he earns a yellow card. That's a warning.
One yellow card. 10 minutes gone. 10 minutes.
Okay. Oh, my. Jason got flung into that
turnbuckle. Allen taking over control of the proceedings. This is a revolting development. Tag, in comes Bucca. He's going to get a free shot to the midsection, is he?
Well, it is time for a tag to be made. Jason has to make a tag with Owen Hart. Owen desperately wants to get in the ring, but Jason cannot get over there to make the tag because he is being pounded from pillar to post by Muck and Singh.
Crowd trail trying to exhort him to get into action. Here comes the Karachi Crunch. It didn't work. Jason spun out of there. Jason getting over, makes the tag. And here's Owen Hart. Knocks Mukka Singh down in the corner, hammers away at him. Owen Hart looking fresh and strong and going to work. Over the top. Did you see him handle at 370?
Owen Hart is a high flyer with all kinds of strength. Here he comes. This could be it. One, two, and bad news. Allen comes in to stop the pin, but it's amazing. Owen Hart greatly outweighed by everybody in the ring, and yet he has such amazing strength to go with his speed. He gives away nothing.
He pulls him down. One. Oh, he went over too far. Owen still hammering away at the big man, still able to pick him up and slam him. He's going to fly. He's from relatively close range. Over the top of him, pulls him down. But Allen breaks it up, and Jason knocks Allen out of there. Owen Hart going to work now against Mukka Singh, while Jason pulls Allen on the other side.
This is a street fight. Everybody's involved. Look at this. Whoa, Jason collides with Mukka Singh. Both men are flat on their backs. Owen Hart gets underneath that clothesline. He kicks Bad News Allen right out of the ring, and he goes out after him. This is uncontrolled mayhem. Back comes Owen Hart. Up on the top rope. Whoa, a cross body block. He's got Mukken down. Two.
He got him. He got him for the three. He got him for the three count. The referee is shaking up. The referee is shaking up. Did he signal three? He did.
Well, he was just in the middle of his third count when Bad News Allen hit him from behind. He signaled them to keep fighting. Now the referee is, he's on Strange Street, right
he's
on the table.
He's been there before. He's been there before. This is going to wind up as a mess. I was certain the referee, and that's the second time he's fooled us tonight, I was certain he had made the three count, but you're right. He gave them the signal to continue fighting, and Jürgen Hermann, again, well, let's use the word incompetent.
This is bizarre. Everybody's fighting, everybody. This ring is just jammed with wrestlers. Whoa, what a bizarre ending to an even more bizarre bout. Owen Hart and Jason the Terrible. Owen, you've got to be very pleased about one thing, and that is you can trust this man, but very disappointed with another, and that is you had Mukken down for the count of three, but the referee got bushwhacked by Bad News Allen.
I'll tell you something. That's why we requested a street fight match. Anything goes, no referee, so there's no one to interfere in the matches. We don't have to worry about some stupid referee that can't count up to three. Now, I'll tell you something, Jimbo. It was a big test for me. I had a lot of things on my mind tonight. I had to worry about if I could trust Jason the Terrible. Well, I'll tell you something. He came through, and he came through big for me tonight. Now, he proved that he's a worthy partner for me. I can confide in him, and I can trust him. And that's what a tag team is based upon, is trust and teamwork. Now, we got that toilet bowl and that big mouth, Bad News Allen, and we got them in a street fight, Jim. Now, I can't think of a better way to end the year. Christmas, I couldn't get a better thing for Christmas to have those two geeks in the ring at the same time in a street fight. Now, a street fight, Jim, anything goes. We can take them. We can ram their head in the post. We can bring chairs. We can bring Jason's axe. I'll tell you what, we're going to bring that axe, and we're going to bust those two coconut heads open, and we're going to get rid of them because I'm sick and tired of them. Jason is sick and tired of them. They've been flapping their mouth off about what they're going to do. Well, I'll tell you something, you guys. It all comes down to 1 week from tonight. You guys, next Friday night in the pavilion here, a street fight, anything goes, and we're going to see just how tough you guys really are, because we're coming in here, and we're going to have our fist taped. We're going to be ready for the biggest fight of our lives, because this is the year-end match to settle it all, a street fight, and you guys are going down. Are you ready, Jason?
A street fight, are you ready for that?
What do you mean? I was born and raised on brass knuckles and switchblades. I only got one thing to say. You better bring your cameras and get some pictures early, because they're not going to look like that after it's over with.
Really?
Being the big TV executive that you are, Ed Whalen, this is one time I'm actually going to try to agree with you. Maybe you better pull some strings and keep this next one off TV, because it's going to be blood, guts, pounding, and hammering, and everything. Early. You might as well not even show
up.
Keep it off TV, because it's going to be a war, Whalen.
I will. Who needs it? Yeah. What a night it has been. Well, if we can get the body together, we will see you next time. But in the meantime, and in between time, that's it. Another edition of Stampede Wrestling. Bye now.
Tonight at 7:30, an intense drama of international intrigue finds a research geologist caught up in dealings between Istanbul and New York on Journey into Fear. Then at 9:30, a woman can't distinguish fact from fiction when an acting class uses her apartment for practice on Alfred Hitchcock Presents. ¶¶